So welcome, everyone, to the National Center for Universities and Business annual lecture. My name is David Doherty. I'm the CEO at the NCUB. That's enough acronyms for one night. There are no fire alarms, which means if one sounds, you've got to head for the nearest exit as quickly as you can. Bashing people up as you go. Ruby said that she's never been in this room, and for me, it's one of the most exciting rooms in England, if not in the UK, because it was in these rooms that the Royal Institution, from about 1799 onwards, began to develop the ideas, the technology, and the science that drove the Industrial Revolution. And those of us of a certain generation grew up watching the Royal Institution lectures in this lecture theatre, which is why we've come here for the past 5 years. Because previous NCUB lectures have included business leaders such as Martin Sorrell, Andrew Witty, and Richard Lambert, who exemplified that mission of turning ideas into growth. And a little later, it's going to be my great pleasure and privilege to introduce Ruby McGregor-Smith, who's one of the handful of female CEOs running a FTSE 250 company to carry on that tradition. But before I invite Ruby up, I'm going to present the NCUB Fellowship for Outstanding Contribution to Business University Collaboration. Last year, we gave it to Rona Fairhead, who's sitting in the front row, who went on to land the top job at the BBC, so we believe it's got some serious mojo behind it. This year's recipient spent 6 years as either Shadow Secretary of State or Secretary of State for Universities and Science before recently standing down. In that time, he demonstrated time and again his commitment to business university engagement, and in particular was passionate about the need for universities and the public innovation system to support small and mid-sized companies. Whilst in office, he commissioned Sir Tim Wilson, a previous recipient of the fellowship, who's also here tonight, to undertake a major review of university business partnerships, which recommended the establishment of the NCUB, and so we're doubly grateful. A couple of years ago, our recipient wrote a book called The Pinch, How Baby Boomers Took Their Children's Future and Why They Should Give It Back, which I think there's a lot of sentiment in this room about that, particularly from the younger folk in it. But this summed up his particular brand of policy thinking, civic commitment, and intergenerational justice, as he called it. So it will come as no surprise to most of you in this room that this year's recipient of the NCUB Fellowship is David Willetts. Unfortunately, David is currently on a flight to China, where he'll be representing the UK at various business university events, and more importantly, accompanying his wife, the artist Sarah Butterfield, to her first international exhibition in Shanghai. But some of you know I come out of the media industry, and we don't let people away that easily. So before he left, I dropped into his office in the House of Commons to present the award. So we run the VT. So I'm delighted to give the 2014 NCUB Fellowship to David Willetts.
David, thank you very much indeed. That is very kind of you. I do appreciate it. And, I think it's something I'll really treasure. I'm only sorry I won't be at the event that you're having. I'll already be in Shanghai, probably looking into university business collaboration.
Yes.
But it's a great thing. And I think setting up the NCUB after Tim's very valuable report was the right thing to do. It's great to see it going from strength to strength, and I'm very honoured to receive this award. Thank you very much indeed.
Well, thank you, David. David gave us a much longer interview, almost a kind of, you know, exit interview, which we'll be putting on our website quite soon. Over the 18 months since we launched, the NCUB's membership has greatly increased, and we've been involved in initiatives that have created jobs, economic value, new ways of thinking about employability, and we were mentioned by the Prime Minister at Prime Minister's Question Time, which is always good news for any organisation, I think. But one of our constant themes has been the ways in which universities and business can work together to increase the number of women in manufacturing, engineering, and computing. And another systematic theme has been, how do we grow and collaborate to grow the next generation of leadership in business and universities? Now, we've got two practical initiatives going on both. The first is our 50 Under 30 program, which brings together future leaders in companies and in the academy. And we have some 50 Under 30 people with us tonight. Give us a wave. There. So grab them afterwards. That's that confident leadership thing we like to see. We know from all of our research that one of the most important ways in which baby boomers can give something back is to mentor the next generation. So we will be developing a mentoring program with the 50 Under 30 Network focused on leadership and business university collaboration. And I hope some of you can find the time to contribute to it. Second, we have established a Women in Leadership group chaired by Rona Fairhead to take forward tonight's agenda on behalf of the University Business Collaboration. And here are some of the thoughts of senior women leaders about the challenges of women in leadership.
If you look at senior leadership in corporate life, only around 6% are executive directors. Movement has taken place, but the executive positions, very senior level in corporations, in medicine, in the professions, and in education, remain resolutely low.
I've worked for HSBC outside the UK for the last 15 years, and coming back to the UK, I was struck at the percentage of women in senior leadership roles in banking hasn't changed considerably, and that frustrates me.
I think the main thing that holds women back is confidence.
Men look at the list of criteria required for a job, and if they have 3 of 10, they think they can do it, and they throw their hat in the ring. Women are almost on the opposite extreme, so they might have 7 or 8 of those 10 skills, but they hesitate.
Honestly, I don't know the answer. I don't think anybody does. But the number of times that confidence, environment, support, lack of role models, and need for women to take risks comes through. I'm chairing the NCUB Women in Leadership Group because I have come to realise that it is too important an issue to leave on the sideline.
I think one of the things that appealed to me about the group was that the members of it come from a very diverse range of companies. So it was very interesting to me to see people who'd gone into a commercial environment straight from university and had obviously been on that leadership track right from the very beginning.
What I'm hoping that we see within the next 5 years is we really start a very open dialogue between business and our educational institutes so that there is far more openness around the opportunities available and some of the challenges that young women face as they progress in their career.
Often people like to recruit or appoint people like them, and I think we have to challenge that to be more brave about appointing people that are different from us.
I think we make a lot of assumptions about why women do things or don't do things. I don't think we actually have a really good evidence base from which we're working, so I think an enormous amount of proper research is needed.
We need someone, male or female, to really champion and message the intent around increased diversity and make more bolder interventions.
I think we've got to help women in all sorts of ways understand what they need to do to take themselves forward.
For any society to grow, you have to make the maximum use of your potential. I do think things need to change.
Why wouldn't we want to bring the opinion, the views, the characteristics and the qualities of half the population to leadership? Because if we build teams like that, we build more successful businesses.
And thank you to everyone who took part in that for us. Anyone who wants to be part of this Women in Leadership program, please contact us. We can't do this. This is something that's done by the network themselves. So next to the main event, Ruby McGregor-Smith was born in Lucknow and came to the UK a few years later with her mother. She studied economics at Kingston University, qualified as an accountant, and joined the FTSE 250 strategic outsourcing firm Mitie via Serco. In her time as CFO, COO, and now CEO, the company has grown from $500 million in turnover to over $2 billion. And Ruby has won more awards than Meryl Streep along the way. With that kind of leadership and experience, Ruby is perfectly placed to help inspire a generation, and I'd like to invite you to welcome her to the podium.
Well, good evening, everyone. It's it's a real honour for me to be here. Little did I ever think when I was little that one day I'd be speaking at somewhere as amazing as this. So it really is very kind to be invited. So thank you. So as you know, I'm the CEO of Mitie Group. Yes, $2 billion of revenues, 74,000 people, quite a large organisation still, although we still like to think of ourselves as quite little. And as much as my industry didn't attract any media a few years ago, in the last 2 years, the outsourcers appear to be in the media more than we probably want to be for many reasons. But it is a fantastic industry. Today, it's 8% of GDP, and 3 million people work in the service industries across the UK. So I think of all the audiences I would speak to, one of my big views has always been we need, as a sector, a huge amount of support from universities to have the best talent coming out of universities to help us grow today. It wasn't until I became CEO of my own business that I realised actually that it was quite a rare thing to be a female at the top of a FTSE business. I hadn't quite realised it was quite unusual to be Asian as well. But it struck me when that did happen to me, and just watching the video we just saw with some of the words that were being said, that I think all women in the UK in business do have a massive role to play in terms of being role models to the next generation. Whatever their roles, wherever they sit, I think it's really important until we have gender equality at the top of business that we absolutely make sure that we focus on the reasons and the barriers of why things don't happen and why and what really needs to change. I think it's really important in business to celebrate diversity. And one of the opportunities I get by running my own business is to make sure that we treat diversity quite differently to many other organisations. I think my sector's in quite an unusual space. The reason I believe I was successful through my career is I joined a really young industry that didn't really start till the late 80s. I joined Serco in the early 90s, not long after I qualified as an accountant. And when you're part of a very young organisation that's just starting, that was 80 million of revenues at the time, that was a billion a few years later, you can really do things quite differently. You don't have the hierarchies and the structures that many organisations today who've been around for a long time do have. And it meant that you could think about talent quite differently. And that certainly happened to me when I joined Mitie. I was the first female on the board in 2002. And I remember my then chairman David Telling and my then chief executive Ian Stewart saying to me, look, we know you haven't done it before, we'll teach you how to do it. And I think that support, an actual belief in me to be able to do a role I hadn't done, was incredibly important. And I think it's actually time for business to take a lot more risk at more senior levels and give people with less experience, a little bit more opportunity, but just support them. But it certainly worked for us. And today at Mitie, we're the only FTSE business with both the CEO and CFO as female. And that didn't come because we thought about quotas. That didn't come at all because we thought about we needed more women. It came because actually our board supported us to get where we are today. And I just wish I could see all businesses do that for their young women. Because I think in terms of mentoring, in terms of the support that they need through different phases of their career, I think that's incredibly important. And a little bit about why it happened to me. In fact, I encounter many of the problems many women encounter. So I found things okay until I decided I was going to have children. And then it was almost impossible to juggle what was a global role at Serco with being a mother of two children under the age of two. And I did what most people don't do in terms of taking risks. I decided to take some time out. And I took a couple of years out, and then I joined Mitie because I felt I needed to almost regroup and actually have some time with my family before I came back into a career. Explaining why I'd taken two years out was quite interesting to the then non-execs of Mitie. They didn't quite understand what it meant just to take some time out to be with your family. But I think we've got to be really honest for women today. Women need to do things slightly differently, particularly if they have families or caring responsibilities when they're older. I think it's really important that the workplace becomes more flexible to adapt. If it hadn't adapted for me, I wouldn't be doing what I do today. I'm the chair of the Women's Business Council, which last year gave a report to government about the main things and the main barriers in business that women faced, and came up with a series of recommendations to really try and break down those barriers and say, well, what is really happening at each stage of the life cycle of a female? And we looked at many things, and there are around 80 recommendations, but the key ones, which I think really resonated with us all were firstly around young girls at school and raising aspirations, actually going in, talking to them, making them understand that actually, if they want to do really well, there is always a way to do well. And I think aspirations at schools, at colleges, at universities of young women need to be massively raised. I think there's no reason why they shouldn't be told they couldn't do a job like mine. They just need to know how they actually need to get there and do it. Careers advice, I think, in the UK at a very young age is massively limited. It's not joined up, it's not particularly understood. And I still think the collaboration between business and schools, colleges and universities is still pretty weak. I spoke at a school in Hounslow recently, part of the Speakers for Schools programme, where I gave up an hour of my time just to talk to 200 young girls aged 14 to 18. And at the end of this very long discussion on what I do for a living, they asked me how much money I earned. And so I asked them to guess. And the maximum they came up with was £50,000 a year to run a FTSE business. But what that said to me, more than anything, was they didn't actually understand what it would take, what the job really was, or that you could actually do really well in business financially, which I think says a lot about where we are today. And therefore, as they all come out of school, how many of them rule out being able to run a business, big or small? I would say it's probably still very limited. So careers advice, I think, was one of the big things we focused on, and actually getting the right collaboration between business and schools, work experience, as kids get older, internships, work placements that are paid for, have to become very much part of what we do today everywhere. It's certainly very sporadic. As a business, as my own business, we're still grappling with the fact that we want to have a lot of graduates when they come out of university. We're still struggling to know which universities to really team with or how to do it. It's not easy for us or other organisations to do it very easily. But I think it's really important for very young people to understand the scope of what careers can be. I became an accountant because my dad was an accountant. It's not necessarily the best reason to do it, but it worked well for me. I had no real idea about what else I could do. And we certainly have urged, as the Women's Business Council, the government to really look very seriously at careers advice for young people. In terms of what else we then talked about, we talked a lot about at the Women's Business Council about flexible working practices in business to really help families, and also about the lack of affordable childcare. If we want to be really serious about breaking down barriers, we have to address some of the issues which are really financial to women. We certainly see it in our own business where a lot of women can't come back to work because they can't afford to come back. And I think that just takes out a fantastic talent group out of our own business, which I think is really wrong. And again, I think a lot more support needs to be done around childcare and around flexible working. I think as well, in terms of enterprise and making sure women can really understand if they want to set up a business, what they could really do, how they could do it. Again, I think the advice on that is still quite lacking in the UK in a joined up way. There's lots of places to go and get information, but actually how do you do it? And how do you actually have the courage and conviction? And how do you get the confidence to believe you can be successful? I think that is huge. The other big point we talked about at the Women's Business Council was also around mentors, and actually mentoring being much more of what we have in business today, and encouraging businesses to have mentors at every level for their people to really support people through their career. I certainly have found that really helpful with two. You know, my previous chief exec has been fantastic for me in terms of A, making me believe I could do what I do today, but also the advice, the support you need when jobs like mine are quite lonely, I think is really important. So again, I think mentoring should become much more a mainstream part of what we see. And again, I think many businesses just need support on how to actually do it. I'm actually really delighted to support the launch of the National Centre of Universities and Businesses Women in Leadership Group, run by Rona. I think it's going to be really fantastic. I think, again, the collaboration I think that is really needed between business and universities is really, really important. I wouldn't underestimate the role many of you have to play in that. And I would really ask all of you to really help business in that we can't do things that easily without support of great young talent coming out of universities today. And it would really help to make sure that the individuals coming out of universities have the right the right thought process on just how successful they could be and understand where there are barriers, that those barriers can very much be broken down. But no, it's a fantastic launch, and I'm sure it will go really, really well. The other thing I want to talk about as well is business culture. Okay, business culture is what I think has to adapt. It has adapted. When I think back to when I first started working, there were no women networks. Nobody talked about women in business. Nobody talked about any of these things. And so things have really changed over the last 15, 20 years, but there's a lot more to do. I think in many different types of businesses, culture is very, very difficult, and particularly around diversity. And if I take it wider than just gender, if you think around disability, around race, around age, many individuals are joining business today where they're not comfortable about being part of a culture that exists. So we shouldn't be surprised today to see that many businesses don't have the diversity they should have at the top of business, but they don't always encourage it. And again, I would, more than anything, make sure that the young people we have coming out of university absolutely demand and expect that they have a very equal workplace in those four areas. You know, if we struggle with women, the statistics on BMEs, the statistics on disability are absolutely horrendous. And actually trying to understand the reasons and the barriers for why those issues exist, I still think there needs to be a lot more work done on them. But culture doesn't really change overnight. It does take a lot of time. And I think we shouldn't underestimate just how far we've come with business culture. It is a lot more open. It is certainly getting better. But I think certain sectors are better than others. Personally, I don't think I'd have been that successful in banking. Not because I wouldn't have been very good at banking, but I'm not sure it would have been easy for someone like me to go through the ranks of that and some other sectors. And I think we should be quite honest about those that have supported diversity, those that have supported different people rising through the ranks than others. And I think there is still a long way to go for many businesses in the UK. In my industry, you can imagine the world of facilities management, from engineering through to cleaning businesses, through to security businesses, is massively male-dominated. But the biggest piece of advice I was ever given was to make sure that what I should be is to be myself and not to really think too much about the differences. We spend a lot of time telling young women the same, don't focus on your differences, just focus on your talent. You're not different. We are all the same. It's all about what's inside. But getting that message across to lots of employees who may face biases, who probably need more support on trying to understand why they only ever hire in their own light, is actually really quite difficult. But business, I think, can certainly get better in that way. So just to summarise, I mean, I'm very focused on making sure that the potential of my business has the best people working for it. But I can only do that if the best people come through at every single level. And that actually starts from young apprentices through to young university students as they come into our business. And what we want more than anything is for them to have the biggest aspirations and to make them realise just how successful they can be and to make sure that we can unlock the talent and the potential that they have. Open cultures, discussing issues, and actually having some massive positive fun in business, I think, is long overdue. And I think it's really time now to change that. I think many of us have moved on from the banking crisis and the challenges that brought us. Actually, young people today, more than anything, need to see the opportunities that businesses have. And it's exciting in business today. It's exciting being part of a growing business. It's exciting doing new things. More than anything, we just need the right talent to support us. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Richard Greenhouse, the chair of the National Centre for Universities and Business. And it's my great pleasure just to thank Ruby. And I'm going to do that in a little while because we're going to have some questions first. But what I took from that, and it was so rich a text that you had, is that the kind of idea that it may be somewhat easier in new businesses, but that we certainly need some new mindsets and new mindsets of ambition, I think. Your example of schools, I think, is so telling, really. And above all, in established businesses, I think often a new culture. I remember from my Unilever days, I was thinking, sitting there, I've got a few examples, but I won't tell you them all. But one of them that comes to mind was when Niall Fitzgerald was running the detergents business. And there were two colleagues, ex-colleagues from Unilever in the room, perhaps remember this. But we had a disastrous period when competition with Procter & Gamble. Niall came in on a Monday morning with his team and said, right, well, how many of you did the washing over the weekend? And nobody said yes. And they were all men. So, of course, there are two things you can put right there. You can get your men to do the washing, or you can start to build a team which has got more women marketing managers and product managers. And, of course, he did the second. I'm not sure whether the first happened as well. Anyway, let's have some questions. I know we've got two which have come in already. Jan, you're one of the people who's going to ask a question, so why don't you go ahead, wait for the microphone, and just if everybody, anybody who asks a question just says who they are, that will be really helpful.
Hi, I'm Joanna. I'm from BAE Systems. My question is, what role do you believe employers have to play in improving the quality of career guidance given to young people, especially women in schools and colleges?
Sorry, I didn't hear half of that. Just say that.
Sorry. What role do you believe employers have to play in improving the quality of career guidance given to young people, especially women in schools, colleges and universities?
I think we've got a huge role to play. We encourage all our people to be part of the Inspiring the Future programme, which encourages individuals to go in and talk about their jobs for an hour a year, go in and discuss what they do and actually bring work to life. I think, you know, I can say this as a mum of two teenagers, school is very different to the workplace, and the transition does take time and can be quite tough. But it's really trying to get kids to understand what jobs are in different places. I think it's massive. But it's actually really hard for businesses, large and small, to work out how to do it well. I think one of the challenges we have is that we're all so busy. It's one of those things that we all know needs to be happening. I think it should be, you know, I'm really hoping that the whole educational sector will really take this, because as kids come out of schools and universities, you know, they should be supported onto that next phase, not just left to say, well, we've done our piece. Okay, it's really important they're supported in terms of where they then go and what they've thought about. So I think it's massive, massively important.
Right, let's take some more questions. Up there, you.
Hello, I'm Sarah Main. I'm from the Campaign for Science and Engineering. Our organisation is quite interested in talking to government about things that they might be able to do that influence some of the things that you've touched on. I just wonder, from your experience, are there any one or two things that you think are within the gift of the government that could be done to positively influence the situation you'd like to see in terms of diversity in business?
Yes, I think there are one or two things that could be quite different. I'm really passionate around flexible working is in business today, but I don't know how embraced that is. And actually really supporting great flexible working, I think, in business would help a lot of individuals and help different types of talent rise to the top of business. And I do have a real thing around childcare. For families, actually, not just for women, but actually, I think the lack of affordable childcare in the UK is causing a real issue to my talent pipeline and everybody else's. And I think it's making individuals, both men and women, make different choices, because it is just so expensive in many parts of the UK. So I think there are specific things you can do. I think there are specific things the government can do. And what they should do is focus just on one or two of those things and really make a massive difference with them. Now, I know they'll say there's no money, but we've got to spend some money on something. And this, I think, is a really useful area to spend it on.
Thank you. All right. There we are. Another one along the row.
My name's name's Holly Else. I'm a journalist at Times Higher Education. I wonder if you have any thoughts on what universities could be doing specifically to support graduates in this area.
I think, again, it's to the collaboration between business and universities in terms of, you know, better support around work placements, paid internships, really collaborating with local businesses of all different sizes. And it does happen in some areas. This is not something that doesn't happen at all. But would I say it? I see it happening consistently across the UK? No, not at all. We certainly don't see it much in our sector. Maybe our sectors are still quite young. We're not well known. We do employ 10% of the UK workforce between us all. And yet no one really thinks about going into outsourcing as a career. It's something my sector needs to do something about. But you can imagine we're not the most loved sector at times as well. So it's quite interesting. But I think the traditional, you know, Britain's changing in terms of the jobs that are on offer. Technology is changing rapidly, the jobs that will exist in the next two decades. And I think there's got to be some really big thinking about how that collaboration really works. Because I don't think today it's fit for purpose, not for the next generation.
Shall we move down here?
My name's Malcolm Skinglow of GlaxoSmithKline. So are there any other countries that have got better working practices than the UK that you've seen?
I think you do. You see different examples in different European countries. I think careers advice is lacking as a whole. I've not seen any great examples anywhere where you could be particularly wowed by it. You could certainly be wowed by certain things in the US on the way they're thinking through flexible working. But I think, you know, we shouldn't underestimate the scale of the challenge, because the challenge, particularly around women in leadership roles, is, yes, the US, I think, is better in certain areas. There's a big debate about whether you should have quotas. I'm not a great fan of quotas, so I don't think that gives you the output you want. But I am a fan of aspirational targets and actually saying, well, if you have a workforce, for example, that is 50-50, male, female, then what is your plan to make sure you have that at every level of management? And we're not there in our business. No business is there yet, I don't think. Not that many are. And how do you make sure you don't just do that as a quick fix, actually you make that really consistent? But that's why I think it starts from actually when kids come out of school, which you can't just magic the change in aspiration and what people want to do. You've got to teach them young.
Let's go up that side now, shall we? Keep your hand up, then that's it.
Hi, Melanie Washington from STEMnet. I think we shouldn't underestimate the impact that parents and teachers can have on choices of young girls. I just wondered what, if you had any ideas or what your view was on how we can engage with parents and teachers to help inform your girls on the choices that they have?
I think it's quite difficult for teachers because I think they're so busy. I think, well, certainly a lot of the teachers I speak to would love to do more, but they don't have the time. Not quite part of your Ofsted examination requirements, is it? It's not the most pressurised thing on their list. They're pretty short resource. And I actually think you need to put a lot more funding into career guidance to help teachers. I think it's unfair to expect them to be able to do everything. They're there to teach in a subject. They can't be everything to everybody. And I think they need a lot more support. In terms of parents, I think that's a really good point. At the Women's Business Council, we came up with some really good ideas around parent packs to really help them to understand the range of opportunities that are out there on careers. But again, I think you'll need to do that in a joined up way through great careers guidance that works not just for kids, but for their families too. And I think, no, I don't underestimate the role of parents in this. But as a parent myself, even I struggle to, you know, I'm great at talking about finance, okay? I'm not gonna be able to talk to my kids about the route to get to everywhere if they like different things to finance. As it is, they seem to like finance at the moment, don't they?
Thank you, Ruby. Julius Weinberg, Vice-Chancellor at Kingston. One of the things I've been challenged about recently is that I should not be narrowly thinking about appointing the best person for the job. I should be thinking about appointing the person to create the best team, which I think has forced me to rethink what I do. It'd be interesting to hear your reflections on being appointed to a team when, as you said, you perhaps weren't ready to do the job and needed support, and whether you continue to take that view forward within your organisation, and how do you balance that best person, best team issue?
I think if you've got the best person, they'll find a way to have the best team, personally. Because I think if you put the best person in any kind of leadership role, they're going to be really good. They should only be there if they're great at building a great team. Because I can't only do what I do with a great team around me. I don't do most things in my team. If it wasn't we're a great team of people delivering a set of outcomes for our group. But we've all got to be good at managing people is all we have. But really, we've got to be great at building teams. If we can't build teams, we're not going to build a great business. So I see them as the same thing.
Can we move across to the other side over here? Right, there's a question here.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Lynn Matthews from EDF Energy Campus. I'm looking very much around the nuclear new build. I manage the education skills programme for nuclear new build. And one of the things that we're really starting to identify is with universities, actually working with universities to maybe work on the curriculum. So when the young people come out, that maybe they're more aligned to our needs. Have you started looking at it in that area rather than just relying on what's coming out? What are your thoughts on actually starting to influence curricula as a group of industries?
We've taken a slightly different view at Mitie, which is that I'm not sure how much I can influence the curriculum, but we spend the first year with our grads, basically them making them work ready, which is not great. So it's almost like a year before we feel they're ready to be in our workplace naturally. And that's where I think more can be done. But I think it's quite difficult. It depends on your sector and what you're in. If you're, you know, if you want to influence the curriculum, I think in one or two areas you can. But I would struggle. I work across 12 different sectors. So I would find that quite difficult to do. So we sadly have had to take the approach that they're not work ready. We'll have to accept they're not work ready. I have to put a program in place when they come in to make them work ready. And which, again, I think you can work on a lot of that from pre-university at school. Because a lot of it for me is around actually understanding if you want to do really well in business, you've got to work really hard. Work ethic's an interesting example of actually explain to young people, it's not over when you leave university, that's kind of when you start. And it's really hard work. Hard work means hard work. And getting them to, you know, the small things, being good at presentations, being really, you can imagine in an industry like mine, service industry, being responsive, being able to speak to people. Those are not always things you're going to learn through a university degree, but through your entire education, you would hope more time could be addressed to those things, because actually they're all great skills to have. But I think we still at school focus very much on an output that is just literally academically focused, but be really great if they could chat a bit more when they turn up as well, you know, and actually be a bit more, have been, you know, supportive if they're quite shy. But it's amazing what we have to do in year one. So no curriculum change from us, no.
Good evening, Ruby. My name's Priya and I've just graduated from the Cisco Apprenticeship Scheme. And I just wanted to get your views on the evolution of apprenticeships and how you see apprentices playing a part in breaking down barriers. And do you have any apprentices at Mitie?
You know, we have a few hundred apprentices at Mitie, so we are massive fans of apprenticeships. I would say today I think they are as important to us as they would be for a graduate. I would say when we work with our apprentices, it means by the time they've worked with us for a while, I'd say in many cases they're better than the graduates we are. I think the fact that they've worked in the workplace, that they're really excited about doing a job of work, I think means many kids today are better suited to doing an apprentice route through a business than necessarily going to university first. So I think it's massive. So for us, I mean, we have a lot more. We have around 500 apprentices across the group, which is a lot more than new grads that we would take on. And again, we also think in terms of commitment, in terms of helping us support the group we're trying to grow, we feel they are more committed and longer term employees. So a huge fan.
Okay, just lady in the third row.
Thank you. Michelle Salinger, consultant, you, and I must say Priya was, used to work for Cisco, and Priya was model apprentice and actually made a video. Made a video for the Bucks UTC to encourage more women into IT with one of her colleagues. So I want to say thank you for that. I think you've picked up a lot of systemic issues. You've talked about aspirations. You know, the girls that you talk to don't have those aspirations. Career service in the UK is pretty much dead, and teachers are responsible for careers, and we should have a proper career service. And also, people tend to recruit people like us. And you've picked up on all of those. Do you do leadership training? Is leadership training maybe one of the ways in which you can address these issues by identifying men and women who come into your organisation and give and recognise them as leaders early on and push them in that direction and support them to get there? Because I think unless you change some of these aspirations, it's going to be very difficult for things to change.
You know, we like others, have... we put a lot of leadership training in across our businesses, and particularly with a lot of our kind of young rising stars, put a lot of mentoring, support, leadership training around them. And also give them quite large jobs so that they get put into pretty high risk environments when they're pretty young to make, and even if they make mistakes, so be it, they need to learn. I think business is really risk averse around doing that. I don't think we are. We probably go to more than another extreme, but I think we are less hierarchical, so our view is if someone's really great, then we will fast track them through to do some really, really interesting roles in our business, and we're quite large, so we can do that. And I think if you do that, then I think again, you know, our view is we'll end up with much better leadership over the next decade the more of that we do, and actually we've been doing it for quite a few years, and I think it works really well.
Super number of questions. Just come back up here, Steph, would you? There's a lady at the check top. Okay.
Green Orton Dubrava, University of Bradford. Ruby, I want to ask you, what is your view in terms of businesses encouraging their employees to learn during their life? Because the business environment is changing extremely quickly, and they need to learn more and more during their working life, and that also applies to women who, after a career break, might need to change completely their career in terms of other career paths. What is your view, please?
I think it's incredibly important that we all believe we can all still learn, and that, you know, the business environment is changing so quickly, there are always things you can learn more for. We've certainly sent a lot of our young rising talent back to one of the business schools to do additional work on leadership. We've, you know, from supporting MBA programs to whatever else it may be that we choose to do, we are massive supporters of that. I think in terms of growing a really great business, we shouldn't underestimate how much development our people need. And again, I think, you know, a lot of the universities have been really supportive of that with us, and we've got some people going through some great programs at the moment. And I think the more of that that's offered, the better. You know, for me, university, you know, going back and working with one of the business schools for some of my MDs, I think is really important. Really important. Should not be underestimated.
Now, it's Tim Stevenson here. I think you have a question. You can almost shout it, but we'll wait for the microphone, and then
Tim. I'm from the University of Leeds. I'm part of the NCUB 50 under 30 sort of young leaders group. And one of the things we're looking at is finding mentors or coaches to drive us through. And I wondered if there was anyone in particular that inspired you to become a leader, or is there anything in particular that you learned that you probably didn't know when you were a fresh graduate out of university that you wish you did?
I'll answer. So in terms of the people that supported me in my career have been really incredible. From my first chief, actually, no, I'll go back to when I was trained to be an accountant. One of the accounting partners that took me under his wing to tell me I could do okay in accountancy, even though I didn't enjoy audit, through to the first chief exec I worked at Serco, who told me when I was around 30 that actually I could run it one day, which I was quite surprised about. And even though I never then did, and I left. But what was interesting was I took great comfort from people supporting me and telling me that I was actually capable of doing well. And I think that we shouldn't underestimate how powerful that is with individuals, that telling people, do you know, you really are capable of great things is not something they appear to hear very often, which I think is a massive shame. We're just very good in business, aren't we? You do 360-degree feedback, and most of it's around criticism. It's never about why you're really good at what you are. So I would say the people that have supported me, in terms of people I've worked for, have been fantastically supportive and encouraging in terms of making me better at what I do every day. And in terms of things I wish I'd learnt when I was 21, I didn't have the confidence to believe I could do really well. I wish I'd had the confidence that I kind of now have, because I think confidence would have really held me back in my 20s in a big way. And self-belief, because no one ever actually really told me that I could do well. And I think for me that was an issue. I think also, the other big thing I wish I'd known was it's okay to make mistakes, because we all make mistakes every day anyway. And on the basis we're always going to get things wrong, not everything goes right in business every day. You just have to accept that getting things wrong is part of what happens every day. And learning from that, I think, would also have been really useful. And taking more risks. No, need to be risk averse.
You're answering a whole load of questions. Are we okay to carry
that's
on?
Fine.
Because there's still a lot of hands going up in the room, and that's great. There's one just behind you, and then we'll come back down here, because I know...
I'm Rebecca Chalawad. I'm the business dean at Buxton University. I think one of the issues for women often is ageism, in the sense that women often in their 20s and 30s are very busy with young children, and it's not until they hit their 40s or even older that they're able then to really commit to a career. And I've seen several women at that age, they suddenly get a second wind and they do very well. I wonder if you, and yet often at that age they're considered to be a bit past it for really good career promotions. I don't know if you have any comment on that.
I don't think it's about your age. I think it's about your mentality, actually. I think it's around, you know, you've got to be young in your mind and be prepared to embrace and change all the time, particularly in a very, very, very quickly moving, fast, dynamic business environment that's changing rapidly. You know, I remember when, you know, I was off on maternity leave with my second child, and suddenly it was the world of the internet and .com hit. By the time I'd got back, everybody had a website. I didn't know what a website was. You know, it was the catching up with technology quickly, being prepared to embrace and change, I think really matters. I think you're right. As my kids have got older, I've certainly found it easier. And I have a little bit more energy now than I probably did when they were smaller as well. But I think it's not your physical age so much, actually, it's around the mentality of what you believe you can do. I meet a lot of women whose kids are growing up whose biggest issue is how do they get back? They're massively talented. How do they get back? What support could they be given? Because the amount of untapped potential in women as they do get older, having had a bit of a career break because actually they wanted to, which is absolutely right, if that's what, you know, we should all do what we want to do. I think, again, it's a big untapped market. There's, you know, we're beginning to see different organisations really
targeting women who want to come back after a long career break, support training, support bringing them back into the workplace. I think that's going to be more and more important, particularly in a world where I think flexible working is very much our future. You know, the days of office bound, this is how we do things, are almost over.
Just come down here, Steph, would you? And a couple of hands coming up.
My name's Wendy Bowers. I'm the representative for Female Enterprise with the British Chambers of Commerce. And I also run an organisation that is building a network of 500 ambassadors across the UK to mentor the next generation of female leaders. I'm in that age group that we've just been talking about. And the thing that's very difficult for me is that I'm coming to the end of 20-odd years of raising four children and thinking that I'm just going to see the light because the youngest one is 16 and now my mother's got dementia, so we're starting with that. There's a lot of people my age that are dealing with that, and in the main, these people are women. What do you think we can do to start changing society's perception that it is the women that always is the main carer? Because I think until we really start to change society's perception around that, we can't change the place of women in the workplace.
I think it's a really tough challenge as you get older. You know, as all our parents get older, we begin to have challenges in terms of needing to support them. I don't think there's any easy answer. Because to change society perception is going to take a long time, a long, long, long time. But equally so, I think, again, my points around flexibility in the workplace will really help, because actually employers can help here by saying, kind of, flexibility is all right. You don't have to be here every day. If you need to go off, go off. I remember on my first shareholder roadshows, my son was star of the nativity play, and Ian, my boss, said, go home. Missed the last meeting, and I was so excited, but I felt so guilty about going, best thing I did. But it was, and actually, what did I really miss? Not a lot. I think once you actually get business to the place where they say, look, we can give you more flexibility, we get it. We don't need to judge it, okay? It is what it is. I think business will be better for it, and I think you'll have employees that are far happier, and happy employees makes for a good business. But society is a tough, I wouldn't know how to deal with that.
Jenny Halley from the National Physical Laboratory. My question is actually linked to society's perception of women as the carer, but slightly more focused on a young family. I'm a mother of a 10-month-old son. And what could businesses actually do, perhaps even with universities together, to make it a bit more acceptable that when the obligatory phone call comes from the nursery to pick up the little one because he has not been very well, that it's actually also acceptable for fathers to take up that particular role? It very much is focused on women and flexible working, but I think there might be something that we can do actually to support fathers in the role as well.
Most of my direct reports are male, and they're quite a few of them have got young children. They have that issue, and I'm kind of, you have to be pretty laid back about it, male or female. Child's ill. Maybe it will help actually when more boards are a bit more family friendly. It's a reality, because I don't think a lot of them are. I get it, because it's happened to me, and it's done. I think every chief exec needs to get it, and everyone that leads a business needs to get it, and I've been through it. And if your child's ill, you've got to go and get them, and there should be no judgment passed about that at all. That will come. It's certainly there in my group. It's only a question of time. I find it quite ridiculous that anybody would find it a problem if someone had to go and pick up a child because they weren't very well, male or female.
May, next to you there, and then we'll take one more. Probably over here.
Hi, Ruby. I'm May Bush. I just work with the president of Arizona State University, and I'm also a coach and have my own business here, so an entrepreneur like yourself. I loved what you said about the people that took you aside and said, you know what, you could really be somebody. You didn't use those words. You used much more eloquent words. I'm curious about the times when you pull people aside now, because I'm sure you're the kind of person that pays it forward. I'm wondering what you are looking for in those people that, or what you see in them that would make you feel comfortable to make that kind of encouraging statement? Or maybe what did they see in you when they made that statement to you?
Real drive, determination, great with people, more than anything, that people want to work with them. There's no, I always say to my people, you've got to be great because no one's going to want to work for you if you're not great fun every day. The simple things in life, nobody wants to get up and work every day for someone that's really miserable. They want to work for someone that makes them feel happier during in their place of work. Otherwise, you don't build great businesses with very miserable people, is a really simple thing I would say. So drive, determination, a great sense of fun, positive thinking, I think, a real sense of positive thinking, not giving you problems, giving you your problems, then saying, but guess what? I've come up with three solutions. Great solution drivers in business, because you need that as well. And also, I will tell people in my business, I'll particularly focus on those that don't necessarily see how good they are and are always prepared to give me the five things they've got wrong as opposed to see actually what they've really got right. So I try and phrase it with people when I talk to them, say, look, these are the things that are really good first. Then maybe, by the way, you want to focus on X, Y, and Z to get a bit better. But I think it's those sorts of traits you look at. Real positivity in business, I think, creates great leadership. Nobody, and I certainly never wanted to work for any team that just had a downer on life every day.
Last question over here, and I've got just two Twitter questions here, which if I don't ask, I'll be in real trouble, Ruben. Is there anybody over here who'd like to ask a question?
Hi, good evening. I'm Rachel Gray from Cisco. I was fascinated and very inspired to hear that you took 2 years out as a career break. You know, personally, I didn't take any time out with my three kids, but I did back off. And what I felt was that there was a perception that I had checked out and that was terminal. And I wonder how, and it wasn't, and I got back, checked back in again, you know, once my kids were at school and I could cope a bit more with the pressures of having three kids. But I wondered how you handled that perception of, oh yeah, you know, she's gone.
It was pretty awful, actually. I remember, my phone stopped ringing and most people didn't want to talk to me anymore, which I think it's the best thing about it for me actually was how much it levels you to realize that actually when you're out of the workplace, no one's really interested, no matter how good you might think you are. So for me, it was actually a really interesting experience to go for. And it did make me very cynical when I then started my new job all that time later when the phone started ringing again. And I was thinking, oh, no. So it taught me a lot. I found it quite hurtful. I found it quite difficult. But equally so, what I did learn was that there are great, you know, from your friends and your family who really support you through that, the people in life that really support you, in business, so those that will be there for you in good and bad times. This wasn't bad. I was taking some time out. I did a bit of part-time work. I went to the gym a lot from memory when I could. Seemed to spend a lot of time building train sets for my little boy. But, you know, I did all the things I wanted to do. And it was really hard coming back in and explaining it. But I kind of just took the view that's what I had to do because it was right for me. And if people couldn't accept me for that, then I didn't want to work with them anyway.
Now then, how would you respond to claims that women have to act like men to get ahead in business? I think we know the answer, but we'll hear it from you.
I wouldn't really know how to act like anything but myself. So I would say, I don't think it's necessary, and I think it's a massive shame if any female feels they have to. They should just be themselves.
Okay, very good. How do you keep your eye critical when you've been in leading the same organisation for many years? I'm not sure he said so many years.
Surround yourself with really good people who keep you very, very current and don't allow you to have any kind of ivory tower around you, occasionally, which I did have. You have to be the kind of person that stays down to earth and doesn't begin to believe their own hype. But most of the people around me make sure I certainly don't believe any of the hype. So.
Okay. Well, Ruby, I think we will draw this to a close. Thank you so much. I was listening with such intensity to what you said, and we covered an awful lot of ground. I was thinking of my own personal context. And the most recent one is my daughter, who's a hospital consultant, said that she said to her six-year-old boy, Joe, I've now been able to change my hours, so I'm taking Tuesday off. And he said, well, why, Mummy? I said, well, I can spend more time with you. But you see me on Sunday, he said. She's taking the Tuesday off, don't worry. I think this has been, David, a unique lecture this time, because it's been so much about you and your experiences and very personal experiences and the whole you, so not just you in business, but you outside as well, that I found that really interesting and genuinely inspirational too. So I shall be following your business with great interest, because I'm sure that under your leadership, it's bound to continue on its upward path. So thank you very much for coming tonight, and we've thoroughly enjoyed having you here. Well, that's the end of the formal part for this evening. If you would like to carry on, I'm sure you would. Across the corridor, we have a reception and, I dare say, a glass of wine. We were talking earlier about the fact that that's now equivalent to a donut, but I know which I would like better, and I hope you would too. Thank you all very much for coming. This is the last of these that I will do, because I'm handing over my responsibilities as chair early next year. I hope you'll agree that under David's leadership, with a great executive and super staff, we have a really formidable organization here, and one that's really, really relevant to today's needs. I'm very passionate about this organization, having been with it in one way or another for 10 years, and I shall follow it with great interest, because I know it has got a lot more to do and it'll do it well. So thank you very much for coming. Let's go and have a drink.